الحمد لله، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والعاقبة للمتقين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين وإمام المتقين، وعلى آله وأصحابه وبارك وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات أولئك أصحاب الجنة هم فيها خالدون. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: من صلى علي صلاة واحدة صلى الله عليه أشرا. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: يا أيها الناس، أفشوا السلام وأطعموا الطعام وصلوا بالليل والناس نيام، تدخلوا الجنة بسلام. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. First and foremost, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And before I say anything more, I'm going to request if everyone can come just a bit more closer to me, if you don't mind. Jazakallah. Just a bit more closer. I feel a bit more. I'm talking to everyone. Jazakallah.
Bring your chairs forward,
sir. Yeah, please, bring your chairs forward too. And secondly, Jazakallah khayran ahsan al-jaza to your respected Imam Sahib Mufti Atiq Hafizahullah for giving me this opportunity on behalf of Wernith Jamia Masjid to come and speak to you on. Alhamdulillah, this Jannah, the ultimate goal talk, it's actually part of a series, and Alhamdulillah, thumma Alhamdulillah, this is the final part. We actually have three parts of this series. There were two the last Saturdays before. We had it in two different masajid, and today, Alhamdulillah, we're in Wernith Jamia. So today is the final part of this actual talk. So some might be thinking, oh no, I missed out the first two parts. So how can I take part? You don't have to worry. Because the way the parts have been designed, even if you were here for the previous two parts and you're here today, it doesn't matter. Alhamdulillah. So before I say any more, now there's a very big question. Mufti Atiq Sahib, Hafidhahullah, yesterday in Jumu'ah Salah, he made the announcement that guys, tomorrow, Saturday after Maghrib Salah, there's going to be an event, a program. Someone's going to speak. And guess what his name is? Atiq. So it's not Mufti Atiq, this is Atiq. So Alhamdulillah, we share something there very common. And Alhamdulillah, other things too, Alhamdulillah. So yeah, Mufti Atiq have said that tomorrow there's going to be a program. So Alhamdulillah, thumma Alhamdulillah, many of you brothers are sitting here. So before I talk about Jannah and I go up or try to explain about Jannah, I want to say something to you. And I'm going to say with a lot of passion, and I sincerely mean it. Wallahi al-azim, I swear by my Allah, I swear by Allah, every single person sitting here, every single person listening online, and every single person being part of this program right now, Wallahi al-azim, you are very, very special in the sight of Allah. Very special. So now there's a question, who are you to say we're special? We know we're special, but who are you to say that? I'm not saying it. Guess who's saying it? My most beloved Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is going to explain to me and you. My idol, Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi, he mentions in his book, the most famous book, Sahih al-Bukhari. In there he has a chapter, Kitab al-Da'wat. And in Kitab al-Da'wat, the last subheading in Kitab al-Da'wat is Fadlu dhikrillahi azza wa jal. The virtue, the blessing of remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wherein Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi narrates a hadith from the authority of Abu Huraira radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Abu Huraira radiyallahu ta'ala anhu says that our most beloved Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam said. It's a very lengthy hadith. So I'm going to try to really give you a summarized version as much as possible just so that I can talk to you about Jannah. So in this hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he has some angels. And alhamdulillah, we all know Allah's angels. And from amongst his angels, there's actually a specific group of angels that they have a specific task. Guess what their task is? Literally, if some of us have this task, we'll be chilling. Their task is to roam around the streets. That's their task. To literally roam around the streets. That's what they do. In this very world, they roam around the streets. Why though? Their roaming around and mine and your roaming around might be a bit different. Their roaming around is only to find places, to find events, to find such environments where Allah is being mentioned. So a few angels, they walk around, or sorry, in their case, they fly around, and they find a place. So today, 1st of October, 2016, after Maghrib Salah, Wanat Jamia Masjid. These angels, they start to gather. In this gathering right now, they gather. It doesn't stop there. One thing is, you know, when me and you, when we're having an event, guys, send you on Facebook, send you on WhatsApp. These angels are too cool. Guess what they say? They don't have to send you on WhatsApp, on Facebook. They say, halummu, halummu ila hajatikum. O angels, come towards that what you are looking for. Halummu ila hajatikum. Halummu ila hajatikum. Come towards what you were looking for. We found it. We found a place where people have gathered. Yahmadun Allah. Yukabbirun Allah. Yumajjidun Allah. They're going to talk about Allah. They're going to talk about His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. That's why they've gathered. So now these angels, they gather around this gathering. And they gather all the way ila sama until they reach the heavens. And wallahu ya'lam, Allah knows everything. Allah knows everything. But despite knowing everything, Allah wants to have a conversation with His angels. So Allah says to His angels, right now this is happening. Literally right now. ماذا يفعل عبادي? What are my servants doing? What have they gathered here for? What's so special about this talk? Why did he decide to sit here for? Why is that person listening for? Why is that person taking part in this program? Why? So the angels say to Allah, oh Allah, they're praising you. They're remembering you. هل رأوني? Have they actually seen me that they're praising me? Has anyone here seen Allah? Please let me know. Anyone seen Allah here? Allah. No one seen Allah. So they, me and you, we haven't seen Allah. The angels are asked, have they seen me? لا والله ربي والله oh Allah, they have not seen you. They have not seen you at all. And still they sit here praising me. They've sat for the purpose of a gathering where you, oh Allah, and your beloved Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is going to be mentioned. They still sit? Yes, they do. So Allah says, ما يسألونني. What do they want? You're not just sitting here for the sake of sitting here. There must be a purpose. So Allah is going to remind me and you about that purpose. ما يسألونني. What are they asking for? What's the purpose? What's the goal of them sitting here? Why are they sitting? Is it just to waste 45 minutes? Is it just to waste their Saturday evening? They must have come for a reason. They must have come for something. And deep down in reality, after me and you pass away, we want to go to a place where the whole talk is about today. Where do you want to go after you pass away? Where do you want to go? You don't sound too keen. Where do you want to go? Where does everyone want to go? Are you sure? Because some people are like, Where do you want to go? They're too scared right now. No. You can't be scared of me. If you're scared of talking, then we're not going to get too far. Where do you want to go after we pass away? Where do you want to go? Jannah. I want to go Jannah too. So guess what Allah's angels say? يَسْأَلُونَكَ الْجَنَّةِ يَا رَبِّي. Oh Allah, they're asking for Jannah. They want Jannah from you. That's what they want. The conversation continues. Allah asks His angels, هَلْ رَأَوْهَا? Have they seen this Jannah that they so passionately want to hear about, that they so passionately want? No, we haven't seen Jannah yet. We haven't seen Jannah. لا والله. Allah, they haven't seen this Jannah. The conversation continues. Allah asks, what is it that they're really scared of? What is it that they want my protection from? What is it? Where do we want to go? Where do you want to go? Jahannam. Ya Allah. I don't want to go to Jahannam. No one wants to go to Jahannam. No one wants to burn in the fire of Jahannam. We don't want to go there. Allah knows this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's angels are informed of this. And they say to Allah, oh Allah, they don't want to go to Jahannam. They don't want Jahannam. They want to stay away from the fire. Hal ra'awha, have they seen this fire? We haven't seen the fire. We only know what our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has informed us with. We only know of the severity of the punishments of Jahannam from what our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has taught us. conversation continues. Now Allah Ta'ala spoke to his angels. Allah wants to say something. And now this is for every single person. Allah says to his angels, Ya Malaika, Ushhidukum, I make you witness. Allah doesn't have to make anyone witness, but he makes his angels witness. Ushhidukum, I make you witness. On what point? Anni ghafartu lahum. I have forgiven every single person sitting in that gathering. That's it. That's it. You've just sat here. And by sitting here, your Allah, my Allah says, Anni ghafartu lahum. I have forgiven them. Forgiven them. Just by sitting here. He doesn't stop there though. قَالَ مَلَكٌ مِنَ الْمَلَائِكَةِ One angel, he is not happy with that announcement. He is not happy at all. He says to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Rabbi, minhum fulanan. Amongst them, there is one person. فَلَيْسَ مِنْهُمْ He's not amongst them. He hasn't come for this talk. He hasn't come to hear about Jannah. He hasn't come. He's come for a different purpose. He's got some other necessity that I'm waiting for someone. Or you know what? I'll just sit. Someone just said sit. He doesn't have the intention of learning. He doesn't have the intention of sitting in this blessed gathering. What about him? He hasn't come for that reason. What about him? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to his angels, such is the blessing of this gathering, no one is left to be despaired. Even that person has been forgiven. Just by sitting in a gathering. That's what my Allah and your Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised me and you. So now the question is, how many times do we hear about events? How many times are we told that before Jumu'ah is going to be an English talk? How many times have we heard that there's a program happening in our masjid? How many times have we heard that there's a program happening in Oldham? Or somewhere where we can reach? But because of one or two excuses, we don't take part. We should ask ourselves, by taking part already you have attracted the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it's a great blessing. Do not take it lightly. That hey, I've just sat down, it's after Maghrib. No. Wallahi lazim, you are very blessed. You are very special that you can take part in a gathering where Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is being mentioned. So may Allah ta'ala accept this much from us right now. Now let's talk about Jannah. The last two talks, what did we speak about Jannah? When we spoke about Jannah, we spoke about how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has so many blessings of Jannah. And from amongst them blessings, we explained how the greatest blessing of Jannah is a hadith of my most beloved Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where he mentions that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he will say to his servants, that do you want anything else? Are you happy? Are you happy with what you have been given in Jannah? And the servants of Allah in Jannah will say, Ya Rabbi, how can we not be happy? وَمَا لَنَا لَا نَرْضَى How can we not be happy? You've given us everything. Every want, every blessing that we ever dreamed, that we could ever imagine, and those things that we could not imagine. You've given us everything. Could there actually be anything more? Thereafter, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to His servants, may Allah make us amongst those servants, that we will hear these words from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say to His servants, that now from this moment on, I am forever happy with you. وَلَا أَسْخَطُ بَعْدَهُ أَبَدًا And never ever again will I ever become displeased with you. May Allah make us amongst those people who will be blessed to hear this. Now, this part of the series, we've got one more thing that we want to talk about. Which is, how do I get to Jannah? Jannah, the ultimate goal. It's the purpose of our lives to reach towards Jannah. To make it so that we live such a life that Allah becomes happy, the mercy of Allah becomes ours, and then we go to Jannah. Now with such a beautiful Jannah, it sounds like, yeah, how am I going to get there? Jannah, you know, it's just too difficult. It sounds like you have to be like super, super pious. And you have to be super, super on point with everything. But you see, the mercy of Allah, it doesn't look at quantity. It doesn't look at what's on the outset. The mercy of Allah is waiting to be triggered by anything small, anything at all. And today, inshallah, I will share with you a few points from the ahadith of my most beloved Rasul, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that what are these small things that me and you can do that Allah will give me and you Jannah with. First of all, my Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Hazrat Imam Abu Dawood, rahimahullahu ta'ala, and Imam Al-Hakim, rahimahullahu ta'ala, mentions in his Musnad, that My Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم said, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من كان آخر كلامه من كان آخر كلامه لا إله إلا الله دخل الجنة. That person who will say his final words on this very earth will be لا إله إلا الله. For that person is دخل الجنة. إسناده صحيح by Imam Hakim رحمه الله تعالى. So a person that on his final stages of life, if he is blessed to say on his tongue, La ilaha illallah, dakhala al-jannah. Now there's a very big question. How many people are actually blessed that on their tongues, on their final moments, on their deathbed, they can say, La ilaha illallah. That they can actually say the kalima. So some people say, that's just too hard. It's not hard though. And I'm going to prove to you that it's not hard by mentioning what I have been taught by my science teachers. You see, in our body, we have organs. And scientifically and in biology, we learn that the strongest muscle in the human body is the tongue. What is it? The tongue. The strongest muscle in the human body is the tongue. So when everything else can fail you, the last thing to fail you is going to be your tongue. It is the strongest muscle in the human body. Okay, cool. Strongest muscle. Now the question is, La ilaha illallah. Now that's quite, you know, if you think about it, it's not one word. You're not just saying Allah. You're saying La ilaha illallah. And for the Qurra, Mufti Sahib Hafidhahullah would know, and inshallah he will address this to you inshallah whenever you do your tajweed classes. There are certain letters in the Arabic language. They're divided into two types of letters. From them two types, one type of letter for me and you to understand is those letters that have a dot on it. So if I go through the alphabet, Alif. Does Alif have a dot on the letter Alif? Any dots on Alif? What about Ba? Does Ba have a dot? Where? At the bottom. What about Ta? Dot. What about Jim? Does it have a dot? Yeah. What about Ha? Does Ha have a dot? Anyone? No. What about Ghain? Does Ghain have a dot? Ghain has a dot. Does Qaf have a dot on the letter? Yes. So in Arabic, them letters with the dots, they're known to be heavy letters. They're known to be heavy letters. And know the letters that are not heavy? For example, Ha. Does Ha have any dots on it? No. What about the small Ha? Ha. Does Ha have any dots on it? No. What about Ayn? Does Ayn have any dots on it? No. What about Lam? Does Lam have any dots on it? No. If we actually thought very closely and we looked at the kalima, La ilaha illallah, every single letter in La ilaha illallah, every single letter is such a letter that is known to be a light letter in Arabic. So Allah is saying to me and you, that, oh my servant, using the strongest muscle in your body, which is the tongue, I expect you to say the lightest of all of phrases on your final moments. That's what Allah is saying to me and you. So in reality, it's not hard. La ilaha illallah. You don't even use any of your lips. If I hold my lips now, everything the Qurra, the Qari will tell you, that you're not using anything from outside. None of your lips are moving. When you say meme, yeah, your lip moves. When La ilaha illallah, it's not only light letters, such letters that are all inside your mouth. Allah is saying when you're in the difficultest position of your life, you're leaving this world and everything's fading, you, even your mouth is weak. You don't even need your mouth. Look at me, watch me. La ilaha illallah. Did you see my lips move? Did anyone see my lips move? Let me say it again for you. La ilaha illallah. Did my lips move? So Allah is saying to you on your final moment, La ilaha illallah is so light, you only need your tongue. And from the light letters in the Arabic language, it is such letters that don't even require the movement of your lips. So that's possible for me and you. But now there's a big question. How can I guarantee that when I'm about to pass away, that I'll be amongst those people that will be blessed, that in our conscious mind we'll be able to say that La ilaha illallah, that there is none worthy of worship but Allah? That means a lot of things in our life are going to have to change for that. Because the reality is, you can't just expect it that, hey, I'm going to pass away and I'm going to say, La ilaha illallah, when I'm passing away in my deathbed. No. A lot of effort is going to have to make. A lot of effort. You will have to strive your whole life just so that you can be prepared for that moment that your tongue is ready, your mind is ready to say, I'm going to leave this world saying, La ilaha illallah. There is none worthy of worship but Allah. And if you are amongst those people, دخل الجنة, for you is Jannah. So that's quite a cool thing, just to say the kalima, La ilaha illallah. What about that's death? That's a, for some might think, oh, that's a very long way away. I'm sorry, it's not a very long way away. It's very close. But because we think it's a very long way away, is there anything else that I can do in this very world, in my actions of day-to-day actions, that will take me towards Jannah? There is. My most beloved Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, did everyone pray wudu before they came for Maghrib Salah? Be honest, are you sure? Everyone prayed wudu. Everyone washed and did ablution before Maghrib Salah. Are you sure? Everyone. No one did a cheeky one which was, I'm running late, so I'm just going to pray without wudu. Did anyone try that one? In madrasa, trust me, a lot of people try that one. Especially Fajr Salah, you're like, oh no. You quickly pray because you have to pray, and then you quickly do wudu again and pray again. So no one did that, right? So let's learn about wudu. There must be something cool in wudu because salah is the key. We know that's the key to Jannah. Salah will take you towards Jannah. Guess what my Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says regarding wudu when you're washing yourself. My most beloved Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Hazrat Umar radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, Umar ibn Khattab radiyallahu ta'ala anhu says, that my Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَا مِنْكُمْ مِنْ أَحَدٍ يَتَوَدَّعُ فَيُبْلِغُ الْوُضُوءِ. That there is none amongst you, but that when he does wudu, he does it properly. What does properly mean? Not the body parts that you have to wash. You make sure that it's been wet. You make sure. Mufti sahab, Imam sahab will tell you that, look, you need to make sure there's no patches. You need to make sure that when you're washing your feet, that your ankle has been, you know, washed. We know that. So Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, that person who does wudu properly, not my wudu and your wudu, the proper wudu, making sure every part has been wet according to the way of wudu. So then, my Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, ثُمَّ يَقُول. Then that person says something after finishing wudu. And I hope a lot of you do this, and I hope the students of Wernat Jamia Maktab and everyone else, I hope you do this, which is that after completing your wudu, my beloved Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Yaqul, a person says, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallahu wahdahu la sharika lak, wa ashhadu anna muhammadan abduhu wa rasulu. That's it. Does everyone know that kalima? Repeat after me then. Say it with me. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك لك وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. If you say that after wudu, listen to this now. If me and you say that and we make it a habit, it's a practice for every single time we do wudu, we say this, my most beloved Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, إِلَّا فُتِحَتْ لَهُ أَبْوَابُ الْجَنَّةِ. That but for that person, the gates of Jannah are opened. They're opened, the gates of Jannah. Does anyone know how many gates of Jannah there are? Anyone here know? How many gates of Jannah are there? Eight gates of Jannah. My Rasul says, إِلَّا فُتِحَتْ لَهُ أَبْوَابُ الْجَنَّةِ الثَّمَانِيَةُ. That the eight gates of Jannah are open for a person when he says, أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَحْدَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَكَ وَأَشْهَدُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا عَبْدُهُ وَرَسُولُهُ. Okay, cool, it's open. Eight gates of Jannah are opened. But guess what? يَدْخُلُ مِنْ أَيِّهَا شَاءَ. He can enter Jannah from whichever gate he desires. Just by making this a habit. Ya Allah! Hazrat Imam Muslim rahimahullah ta'ala mentions this hadith in his book. That just by saying after every wudu that you and me perform, أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَحْدَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَكَ وَأَشْهَدُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا عَبْدُهُ وَرَسُولُهُ. Then for that person, the eight gates of Jannah are opened and you can decide wherever you want to enter from. So isn't that easy for me and you? Isn't that something that me and you can do? And then inshallah through this, the mercy of Allah will be attracted towards me and you. That Allah, His mercy will descend upon us. And that will become the excuse for me and you to enter Jannah. And you know, the mercy of Allah is a very big thing. And I'm going to talk about the mercy of Allah. Why? Because the companions of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they were sitting with the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Messenger of Allah said, no one will enter Jannah except through the mercy of Allah. And the Sahaba were amazing people, radiyallahu ta'ala anhum. May Allah ta'ala continue to shower His mercy upon the Sahaba, radiyallahu ta'ala anhum. May Allah make us amongst the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Jannatul Firdaus. You know why they were cool? Because they, for me and you, made everything easy. There should be a question here. Rasulullah said, no one will enter Jannah except through the mercy of Allah. So one Sahabi, Qila ya Rasulullah, he was said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wa anta, even you, you're the Messenger of Allah, you're rahmatul lil alameen, even you, are you not going to enter Jannah? The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, even me, I also will enter Jannah through the mercy of Allah. Even Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will enter Jannah through the mercy of Allah. And do you want to know what the mercy of Allah actually is? I mentioned this hadith last week, and I'm going to mention it to you again today. This hadith is, I studied this hadith with my respected teacher from Darul Ulum Bari, Mawlana Ziyaul Haqsab, Hafidhahullahu Ta'ala, who was very blessed to study this hadith under his teacher, who was his father, Sheikh Islamul Haq, Rahmatullahi Alayhi. So we studied this hadith in Mishkatul Masabih, and the actual hadith is from Ibn Majah. In this hadith, my beloved Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that on the day of Qiyamah, when people have been taken and they have been allocated towards Jannah and Jahannam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He will make two people come out of Jahannam. Allah will make them come out of Jahannam. Allah will ask them, how did you find Jahannam? How did you find the fire? And that's a question in itself. How did you find Jahannam? How did you find the burning fire? How did you find Jahannam? So the two servants of Allah reply, saying, Ya Allah, there is nothing worse, there is no punishment, there is nothing worse than this fire. This fire, this Jahannam, is the pinnacle of all of your, from all of the creation that you have created, from all of the evils that can possibly come to us, from all of the punishments that can come to us, this fire is enough. This fire is the worst of all of punishments. This is how we found it. So these two are standing in the court of Allah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, okay. And remember this, that you went to Jahannam because you chose a path. You chose the path to go against me. I have not oppressed you in any sort of way. You chose your path, and because of you choosing your path, today you have been sent to the fire of Jahannam. So Allah says, go back to Jahannam. Both of you, go back to Jahannam. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says this, one of the two, he turns around and he runs towards Jahannam. He runs. He sprints towards Jahannam. And the other, standing still. He's not moving. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to the one that's sprinting back, stop! Come here. Why did you run back to Jahannam? I asked you, how did you find Jahannam? And you said to me, it is the worst of all of places. You said that this is the pinnacle of punishment. So why are you now running back towards Jahannam? Why are you running back for? You said it's the worst place. Why are you running back to it? So now listen to the reply of the servant of Allah, that he will say this to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Ya Rabbi, O my Allah, in this very worldly life, I disobeyed you time after time after time after time. And then today when you took me out of Jahannam, and then you asked me these questions, and thereafter you said, go back to Jahannam, I realized that this is the final ever opportunity I will have to accept a command that you have given me. When you said to me, go back to Jahannam, I wanted to hasten towards fulfilling that command of yours. This is why I ran towards Jahannam. Allah says to that servant of his, that because of this, wanting to fulfill my command, my mercy still remains for you. Go to Jahannam. For him. The second person, he's not moving. He's not listening to the command of Allah. Allah asks him, why did you not move? And the servant of Allah says that, oh Allah, it was my good thought regarding you, that you have taken me out of Jahannam once. I couldn't comprehend the thought that my Creator would send me back to Jahannam. I couldn't understand that thought. that how can my Creator now, after taking me out, after questioning me, how can He make it so that I go back to Jahannam now? I had that good thought and I had that hope in your mercy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to that servant, for you is my mercy and for you also is Jannah. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives to His servants. So the mercy of Allah, we just don't know. So when you're out there and you're seeing everyone, and just because he doesn't dress like you, and just because he doesn't probably act like you, and just because he doesn't look or she doesn't look as religious as you, I'm sorry, that does not give you the certificate to start judging and saying, this person is very, very far. But for me and you personally, we know exactly where we are with Allah. I know where I stand. I know how far I am. And I know how much I have to work with. So we have to think about it for ourselves. We're not here because Allah wants to make me stand on the day of judgment and say to me, give an account for Abdullah. I don't have to stand for Abdullah. I will have to stand for myself on that day. So I will have to answer for my misdeeds. I will have to answer for my errors. So isn't it better that I become busy in trying to fix my life than in trying to look at the faults of others? May Allah make us amongst those people that focus on their own problems. And you know why it's so severe? I will share to you the hadith of my Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from the most honorable Imam Muslim rahimahullahu ta'ala, who mentioned that on the day of Qiyamah, now this is a very severe hadith. On the day of Qiyamah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be conversing with two people. Amongst them two people, one in this very worldly life said to another, Allah is not going to forgive you. You did so many bad deeds. Astaghfirullah. Allah can't forgive that. You did such a bad deed. Allah is not going to forgive you. La yaghfirullah. Allah is not going to forgive you for that. Never. On the day of Qiyamah, Allah will make them both stand. Allah will say to that person, who were you? Who were you to limit my mercy? Who were you to say to my servant that I will not forgive my servant? Who were you to make the decision for me? Who are you to say to that servant that, bro, you've done so many bad things, you know, there's no way back. Sister, you've done too many bad things, Allah's not going to forgive you. Who are you to say that? Because you said that against my servant, then you become witness that I have forgiven him, and for him is Jannah, and for you making that comment, for you is Jahannam. The tables turn. Something to really think about. That in our lives, why is it? Why is it that we are becoming the means of hurting others? Why have we become this? Why don't we work on ourselves? And you know what? Now I'm going to tell you a hadith from my most beloved Rasul, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that's going to make you think. That you know these things that we really judge, which is friendship, which is being sociable, having friends, being good to people, that goes a very long way, a very long way. My most beloved Rasul, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentioned an incident from the people of the past in front of his companions, radiyallahu ta'ala anhum. Hazrat Imam Abu Huraira, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, mentioned this hadith. Hazrat Imam Muslim mentioned this hadith in his book. That, anna rajulan zara akhan lahu fi qadiyatin ukhra. That there was a man. And listen to this very carefully, and after we understand this hadith, I will tell you what made this person eligible for Jannah. There was a man, and he had a friend. He had a friend in a different city, in a different town. And what did he decide to do? فَأَرْسَدَ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ مَدْرَجَتِهِ مَلَكًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had already allocated an angel. Allah said to this angel, that I have such and such a servant of mine. He was on the path from this town towards another town. I want you to ask him a few questions. Amongst the questions is, ask him, where is he going? Why is he going to see this person? If he replies in such and such a way, then from me give such a reply. Give a response back from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now this person is on the way towards a different town, different village. فَلَمَّا أَتَى عَلَيْهِ قَالْ. The angel comes to this person whilst he's traveling to this other town and asks him, أَيْنَ تُرِيدْ. Where are you going? You know, where are you going? Okay, from Oldham to Manchester. Okay, so why are you going from Oldham for? قَالَ أُرِيدُ أَخًا لِي فِي هَذِهِ الْقَرِيَةِ. I'm just going to visit a brother, a friend of mine. He lives in such and such a town. I'm just going to visit him. Okay. قال, the angel says, هَلَّكَ عَلَيْهِ مِن نِعْمَةٍ تَرُبُّهَا عَلَيْهِ. Has he favored you in some sort of way that, you know, in the past he might have given you some money, you might have borrowed some money from him. Now you're going just, you know, keep face, to keep him happy. You're just going to visit him, or you might have gone just to go visit him for a favor, that now you need help with something. You know what? That guy knows stuff about that. Let's go to him.
Are you going for a certain reason? Are you going for a favor? Oh, you know, why are you going? قال لا لا غير أني أحببته في الله تعالى. I have no reason. The only reason is أحببته في الله تعالى. I'm only going to visit him because I love him for the sake of Allah. That's it. That's why I'm going to visit him. That's it. I'm going to go visit that friend of mine because I love him for the sake of Allah. Know the motive. Know the ulterior motive. Know the intention. Just on the basis that I love this person. قال ملك. The angel now, because Allah said to him that if he replies in a certain way, if he replies accordingly, then say this to him. The angel says, فَإِنِّي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ إِلَيْكَ. I am a messenger of Allah. I am a messenger of Allah, i.e. I am an angel that has been sent to you. بِأَنَّ اللَّهِ. From who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because قَدْ أَحَبَّكَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to hear this. Allah wants you to hear that قَدْ أَحَبَّكَ. That Allah loves you. كَمَا أَحْبَبْتَ. The way you love your friend, Allah also loves you. If Allah loves someone, is that person going to Jannah or Jahannam? Can someone give me the simple equation? That if Allah loves a person, where do you think that person is going to go? Where is he going? Jannah. That's where he's going. Because Allah loves him. Over what? Because he spent 15 hours in a day doing tahajjud? Is it because he spent 15 hours in the masjid and he forgot every other rite? Or was it because he just went to visit a brother for the sake that he loved that brother for Allah? That's all it was. So why have we made deen hard upon us? Jannah is the goal, but it's about attracting the mercy of Allah. When we will allow the mercy of Allah to come to me and you, then everything becomes mine and yours. Do you know what? On that topic of love, I want to share something a bit more with you. And this is absolutely amazing. I love to share this. The reason why I love to share this is because whenever I think about this, it makes me just think to myself that, yeah, this is the name when we say love and muhabba. This is muhabba. This hadith is mentioned by Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi in Al-Adab al-Mufrad. Because alhamdulillah, I teach Al-Adab al-Mufrad, this hadith has literally been implanted inside me. I completely love this hadith. Before I say this hadith, I'm going to explain to you how this hadith works. What's your name? Your name? Zain. What's your name? Zain. Okay. Zain is sitting in front of me. Okay? Zain! He's waiting. He's waiting. You know, what's he going to say to me? So I pause for a bit. Then I say to him again, Zain! And you can tell I'm going to say something. Can you see? Zain, do you think I'm going to say something to you? You know I'm going to say something. Zain! So Zain's like, what's going on here? You know, okay, this is going to be really important. Zain, I want to tell you something. I think you're so cool, mashallah. You're a cool guy. He's a cool guy, mashallah. But let me tell you now what happened to my Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is sitting with his companions. And from amongst his companions, this companion that Rasulullah was speaking to was Mu'adh bin Jabal radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. So remember this, I did it with Zain. When I said Zain and I paused, Zain's like, oh my God, what is he going to say to me? Just say it. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Ya Mu'adh, oh Mu'adh. So Mu'adh says, Labbayka wa sa'dayka ya Rasulullah. Oh Messenger of Allah, I'm here. What is it? Say it. Rasulullah doesn't say anything. Ya Mu'adh, Labbayka wa sa'dayka ya Rasulullah. You know, say I'm here. What's taking so long? You say it. Third time. Ya Mu'adh. Oh Mu'adh. Labbayka wa sa'dayka ya Rasulullah. Oh Messenger of Allah, you know, I'm here. So imagine if I just, you know, kept you on a cliffhanger that I just say, Rayhan, Rayhan. And just say it, man, just say it. You know, what's so important? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is doing this with Mu'adh. Three times says his name. Ya Mu'adh, Ya Mu'adh, Ya Mu'adh. So now you have to understand this. If Rasulullah is doing this with him, the next sentence that Rasulullah is going to say to Mu'adh is going to be probably the most important sentence that Mu'adh radiyallahu ta'ala anhu is going to hear from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why? Because three times the Messenger of Allah got the attention of Mu'adh. The Mu'adh, Mu'adh, Mu'adh. And he's like, you know, labbaik, I'm here. You know, what is it? I'm here. You know, tell me. You know, sometimes someone says to you, oh, I need to tell you something. Oh, forget it. Oh, that's the worst feeling ever. Just say it, man. What do you mean? I'm going to tell you, I'm not going to tell you. But Mu'adh radiallahu ta'ala is delayed. Ya Mu'adh. And now I know for a fact, 100% I know sitting here, there are some people thinking, you say now, then why are you delaying me for? I know you're thinking that. So you say it now, why are you keeping us going? I'm going to keep it going. I want to see how long until someone says, just say it, man, just say it. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ya Mu'adh, labbayka wa sa'adayka ya Rasulullah. 3 times over. So remember this, it has to be such a sentence now. It's going to be like the crucial advice. Don't you really care for someone and you say to them, Mufti Saab, I want to speak to you. And the thing you're going to say, you know, you've got his attention, you've got his love, you know he's listening to you, and you're going to give him some words that you want him to remember, you want him to really think that it's important. The Messenger of Allah did that with Mu'adh. So now it could be like, you know, Mu'adh, make sure you pray Salah every single day. Mu'adh, make sure you do this. Mu'adh, make sure you do that. It has to be like the most crucial sentence ever. So now Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after saying it the third time, Ya Mu'adh, and Mu'adh says, Labbayka wa sa'adayka ya Rasulullah. Now Rasulullah is going to say his sentence. Rasulullah says to Mu'adh, Ya Mu'adh, Inni uhibbuka fillah. Oh Mu'adh, I love you for the sake of Allah. That's all it was. Nothing more. Nothing less, nothing more. Oh Mu'adh, I love you for the sake of Allah. That's all it was. I love you for the sake of Allah. That sentence from Mu'adh was, that's it, that's my life. My Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam loves me. My Rasul got my attention that many times over just to say that to me. And today, because of the recent climate, what's happened to us? We are people of Jannah, and what are we doing? The work of the people of Jahannam, that we hurt others. You know, to have in your conscience that you can hurt others, that you feel good when you're hurting others, how can that be okay? How can that be okay for anyone? That's not okay. How can it be so that you are hurting someone physically, with mental abuse, physical abuse, children, teenagers being bullied, and we think it's okay? That is not the people of Jannah. That is not the people that Allah Ta'ala promises Jannah for. In this hadith of my Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, final two hadiths I'm going to finish off with. In this hadith of my most beloved Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised Jannah for certain people. My Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Hazrat Imam Tirmizi rahimahullah ta'ala mentions this hadith in his collection of hadith from Hazrat Anas bin Malik radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, who says that qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Messenger of Allah said, man taraka al-kadhiba wa huwa batilun bunya lahu fi rabatil jannah. That person who lets go of lying, he doesn't lie, he's a truthful person. And you know how me and you can really apply to that? When you know someone's going through a hard time, when you know that there's a victim, when you know in school, at work, please do not think that bullying is limited and hurting others is limited to a school setting or a maktab setting. No. People are bullied at work. People are bullied in their own homes. People are bullied in school. And if you know that some of your classmates are suffering, then it's for me and you not to hide the truth anymore. Me and you, if you know that person can't stand up for himself, because he's going through a hard time, he's being threatened time after time, that if you tell the teacher, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that, then isn't it my duty, the one that's in that setting, the third person, the fourth person, that I go and speak out, that I go and inform those that can help this person? Isn't that up to me and you? A person who lets go of lying, he lets go of lying and he lets go of this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, that for him, he will be given a place in Jannah, in the lower stages of Jannah. Rabat in Jannah. وَمَنْ تَرَكَ الْمِرَاءَ وَهُوَ مُحِكٌ بُنِيَ لَهُ فِي وَسَطِهَا. And now the most common one amongst many people, arguing, fighting. No, I'm right, you're wrong. No, bro, I'm right, you're wrong. Bro, trust me, it's this way, I'm telling you, I'm right. For the sake of Allah, let it be. من ترك المراء. That person who lets go of arguing. No, why argue? What's the point of arguing? Do your own thing. A person who lets go of it for the sake of Allah, for that person he will be given a place in Jannah, in the midsection of Jannah. So these are very two powerful traits. Stop lying. Stop arguing. Now there's only one more extra section in Jannah now. The greatest section of Jannah. A'laha. The greatest section of Jannah. Now that third action is going to have to be a very big one. For me and you to reach up to the greatest section of Jannah. My Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, listen to it very carefully. وَمَنْ حَسَّنَ خُلُقَهُ. A person who has good character. بُنِيَ لَهُ فِي أَعْلَاهَا. For him, he will be given the lofty positions of Jannah. For having good character, for having good conduct, for being kind to others, for showing love to others, for showing respect to everyone. He will be given where a high place in Jannah, the highest place in Jannah. If that's not enough, let me say another hadith of my most beloved Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Imam Tirmizi rahimahullahu ta'ala, he mentioned this hadith, and alhamdulillah, thumma alhamdulillah. Today morning, Saturday morning, 1st of October, I sat in the durus of my respected teachers, and from the durus, in the dars of Sahih Tirmizi, in the lesson of Tirmizi, my respected teacher actually said this hadith to me, to ourselves, our classmates, and we were there present while this hadith was being taught to us. This hadith has been mentioned by Abu Huraira radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, who says, سُئِلَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهُ وَسَلَّمْ أَنْ أَكْثَرِ مَا يُدْخِلُ النَّاسَ الْجَنَّةِ. The Messenger of Allah was asked, that, okay, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we've heard a lot about Jannah. You've told us about Jannah, and you've told us how so many people will go to Jannah. If you do this, you'll get Jannah. If you do that, you'll get Jannah. O Messenger of Allah, but after all these things of getting to Jannah, what's the most common? What's the most common way that people will get to Jannah? My Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, قال sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, تَقْوَى اللَّهِ. By having the consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. By having taqwa. And I always make a point to mention this point. Taqwa does not mean being scared of Allah. It's not about being scared of Allah. Zain, if your dad said to you, Zain, why did you do that for? Were you scared of your dad when he said that to you? You'd be scared. I'd be scared. He might have said that to me. But Zain, I want to ask you a question. When your dad said to you, hey Zain, why did you do that for? You were scared of him, right? Were you scared of him? You're scared of me right now, I'm sorry. But you were scared. I want to ask you a question. Did you stop loving your dad? Do you still love him when he was shouting at you? Or do you sometimes you might say, oh, I don't like him. You go to mom, oh, me, I don't like him. You know, look where he always shouts at me. But you still love him, don't you? You love your dad. Yeah? May Allah Ta'ala give you a dad. Father's alive. Your father. May Allah Ta'ala increase your father's age. May Allah Ta'ala make you a means of sadaqah jariyah for him. May Allah accept you for the service of deen and everyone sitting here. So when Zaid's dad shouts at him, he's scared of his dad because dad's telling me off. But he loves his dad. Taqwa does not mean that you fear Allah. It means you fear the disobedience of Allah. That I love my Allah and I'm scared of making my Allah unhappy. That is taqwa. So those people who will have this thought, how can I go against Allah? How can I hurt someone else? Allah's not going to be happy with me. You're scared that Allah won't be happy. You're scared to make Allah unhappy. That's taqwa. That's one thing Rasulullah said. The taqwa Allah. Through the taqwa of Allah, meaning those people who fear the disobedience of Allah, they'll go to Jannah. They'll be amongst the majority. Who else? وَحُسْنُ الْخُلُقِ. Those that have good character. Through good character, many people will go to Jannah. And no one here can say to me that, ya Allah, character, you know, how am I to achieve that? If you said it was something else, I understand that, I respect that. But good character, you don't have to be Maulana, you don't have to be Hafiz Sahib, you don't have to be Haji Sahib, you don't have to be Ustad Sahib, you don't have to be Imam Sahib. You just have to be Muslim, you just have to be human to have good character. That's what you need. So my Rasul and your Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says to me and you that good character will be the way towards Jannah. And you know what? I'm sorry to put it this bluntly and in this sort of way. That's where we're failing, guys. That's where we're failing. Why? Because we're so petty. You know, if I do this, you know, it's a sunnah, so I'm going to get there. Cool. MashaAllah. Yes, sunnah. Amazing. Miswak. Absolutely amazing. You know, if I do this, as a sunnah. Entering the masjid with the right foot. Yes. Great sunnah. Yes. Great benefits. But have you forgotten that my Rasul and your Rasul, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he didn't spend all day in the masjid. His life wasn't just using the miswak. It wasn't just entering the masjid. It wasn't just entering right, left foot, eating with your right hand, etc. It wasn't that. There was a big part of mine and your Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's life that was about good character. The way he was with his friends, with his companions. The way he was at home, with his family. And that's what matters. I can sit here all day long. I can pretend to be all pious. But if I'm a tyrant, if I'm evil, the way in my conduct at home, then what have I achieved? Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha was asked, that, you know, the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you know, public figures, they have a public life, they have a private life. Let's find out what the private life of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How was Rasulullah at home? Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha says, he used to patch his own clothes. He used to help with the food. He used to be there fixing his own shoes. He used to be there preparing the wood. He used to be there helping us. He used to be there in the home with us, spending time with us. His life at home, Hazrat Aisha, if your wife, trust me, I'm not married, but I know this much. If your wife can say to you that, yeah, my husband's a good guy, then you don't need anyone else's certificate. If you are a good guy at home, you are a good guy. Every married guy knows that. And I got biwini keh diya, mashallah, wa chahe, sahi achahe. Yeah, actually, he's a good guy. If your wife says, no, he's this, he's that, then you got a problem. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, all of his wives, never will you find a complaint against Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in these regards at all, in any sort of way. This is my Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So what message do I want to leave you guys with yourselves and myself? A very big reality check. Jannah is our goal. But to get to Jannah, we need to work on it, guys. We need to really work on it. And I'm not just saying this to, hey, I'm going to go and I've said this. No, please. I'm not going to leave you with, for example, right, do this action for you is Jannah. I'm telling you for the rest of your lives now. But please, better yourselves. Become better people. Become better friends. Don't believe in this fake life. I mentioned this yesterday in our class. I'm going to say it to you guys. I'm sorry. You know this fake life on social media and Facebook and having the likes and having the friends? I'm sorry, man. Tell me. You tell me from them 300 followers, from them 1,000 followers, who is actually there for you? Do you know why people are hurt? Do you know why it's hurting us? And I'm very honest with you. I'm going to finish up this because I know I'm going a bit more extra time. Please forgive me for this up. But I want to mention this point to you guys, which is, what's happening in our areas? Is it just for me to go to Jannah and not find my friends and my family there? It's a collective effort. So what's happened to us? That in life, we don't even conduct ourselves properly with people. Why is it that it doesn't hurt us that me and you are sitting in the masjid, but there's brothers, sisters out there that are suffering? Are they not mine? Are they not my brothers and sisters? Do you know when you're outside and you're seeing that brother? That much, if you can't speak to him, at least smile at him. Let me mention an incident to you. A brother, far from deen, may Allah ta'ala bring him back to deen. May Allah guide him. He said this, and I met this brother. You know what he said to me? For the first, I salamed him. I said, assalamu alaikum. I didn't think much of it. Assalamu alaikum. You know, you salam every Muslim. I salamed him. You know what he said to me? Wallahi al-Azim, this is not a fake story. This is a true incident that's happened to me in my life. I gave salam to a brother. Guess what he said to me? He goes, bro, wallah bro, you are the first person in 4 to 5 years in my life that I've heard someone say salam to me. Why? Because he's out on the streets. Because he's out late night. He's doing the wrong things. So people are like, you know, wo gunda hai, wo badmash hai, he's this, he's that. He's my Muslim brother. He's my Muslim brother. And here's another problem. No, that's not my brother. That's Abdullah's brother. That's, Zain's sister. That's Abdullah's sister. That's Abdullah's uncle. That's out there on the streets. That's where we've gone wrong, guys. Do you know whose brother and whose sister he actually is? You know that sister that's finding it hard to come on deen? Do you know why she can't come on deen? Because no one loves her. Do you know why? Because me and you say, well, that's someone else's daughter, someone else's sister. Let me tell you whose sister is. It is my sister. Whose sister is it? My sister. And I'm going to say something more harsh and more sensitive now. Those sisters, those brothers out there that are going against the commands of Allah, those Muslims, we're talking Muslims here, in our areas, we're talking Gurneth, we're talking Coppice, we're talking Oldham in general. There are sisters, there are brothers, sisters in particular that are selling their bodies. Sisters in particular selling their bodies. It's not someone else's sister, that's my sister. That's my sister. That's your my sister. That's selling her body. Why? Because she has no one else. Because no one else accepts her for. Because she doesn't wear hijab, so she's a very bad person. Why have you told her about hijab? That brother who's on the street, he's doing everything wrong. But he's my brother, he's my ahi, he's my brother, he's mine. Just because you're opening to the masjid, what have you achieved? If you're looking down on others, what have me and you achieved? What have we achieved? Wallahi al-Azim, if we don't wake up today, you know what's going to be more upsetting? Today maybe it's not my actual biological sister, my biological brother, but tomorrow it will be my brother, my daughter, my sister. Then it's going to hurt. Then it's going to be like, why did I not stand up to this? Why didn't I have that concern? We need to ask ourselves. It's not enough. I'm sorry, doing one bayan is not enough. Just because me and you are coming, when was the last time you said to that brother, Assalamu alaikum bro, hope you're well. Just that much. You know that he won't come to namaz the first day. He won't come for salah. But have you spoken to him or have you completely abandoned him? Yeah, that sister doesn't wear hijab. She doesn't dress appropriately. Okay, I understand that. But she's still your sister. She still believes. Maybe there's something in her life 10 times better than what's in my life. But they're mine and yours. Mine and yours. And this concern doesn't come overnight. It doesn't come from one bayan. It comes from thinking about it. That my Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we find in his life that he would stay awake nights crying for the ummah. And I know I said I was going to say one more hadith, but I'm going to mention this hadith to you. And I'm sorry for, and please forgive me for taking more of your time. Final hadith and I will round you up. I'm sorry, I feel very passionate about these things. And when I want to say something, I want to leave you with the message that you need to go back understanding this. My Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Kitab al-Tawheed, amongst the final few hadith of Sahih Bukhari, Hazrat Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam hadith, a very lengthy hadith mentioned by Abu Huraira radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, who says, on the day of Qiyamah, all of the people will be gathered. And when they are gathered on the day of Qiyamah, then they will go towards their prophets. Of that time, the prophet of their time, they will go towards their prophet. Every single prophet from Hazrat Adam alayhi salatu wasalam will say, Ya Rabbi, nafsi, nafsi, Ya Rabbi, nafsi, nafsi. I need to answer for myself today, please, don't come to me. Every nation, every people will go towards their prophet until they come to Hazrat Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. Hazrat Isa alayhi salatu wasalam will say that, Ya Rabbi, nafsi, nafsi. That I have a few things that I feel Allah might make me accountable for. Allah might ask me regarding my people. Allah might ask me that, why after you, why did people do this? Why did they do that? Ya nafsi, nafsi, I can't do anything for you. If you want to go to someone, go towards Ahmad, i.e. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The people will go towards Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and they will complain to the Messenger of Allah. And this is known as Shafa'atul Uzma, the greatest intercession that will happen on the day of Qiyamah. They will go towards Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Messenger of Allah. You are the Habib of Allah. Help us. And now the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he will fall down into prostration. He will praise Allah. He himself says, I will praise Allah with such words that no one from the creation of Allah has ever praised Allah with these words. I will be the first on that day. To the extent I don't even know what these words are today. Only on the day of Qiyamah will I be inspired to say these words and praise Allah. Allah will say to him, Irfa Ra'asak. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, raise your head. Salma shit. Ask whatever you want, you will be granted. Ask whatever you want. So now that's a very big ask. Allah is saying, whatever you want, ask. That's what my Rasul says on that day. Ya Rabbi, Ummati, Ummati. Ya Rabbi, Ummati, Ummati. Oh my Allah, my people, my people, my people. This asking from Allah happens how many times? 4 times altogether, as mentioned in this hadith. 4 times over. And every time Allah says, those people that had iman in their hearts, I forgive them and I give them Jannah. Those people who had some iman, I forgive them. Those people who had an iota of iman, I forgive them. On the 4th time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Dharra, 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 dharra. That person who had even a splint, even an atom's worth of iman, through the intercession of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I will forgive them. Why? Because on that day he said, Ya Rabbi, Ummati, Ya Rabbi, Ummati. And me and you are the Ummati. Me and you are the. So it is our responsibility. And no one saying that after today, that let's go call the whole of world for Isha Salah. No. Akhlaq. Akhlaq. Learn from your Imam Sahib. Learn from Mufti Sahib. Learn how to communicate with the people. Learn how to attract the youth towards Allah. And if you do that, Wallahi al-Azim, no, you will make yourself a very proud person. You will become a hero. And on the day of Qiyamah, inshallah, you will be amongst the shining stars. Because you made an effort. So please, leave back with this. that me and you want Jannah, whilst me and you want Jannah, we're going to work with it. We're going to work for it, we're going to work with it, we're going to work with our brothers and sisters, those that are not hearing this message. Now you need to go tell them that Allah loves you, man. Allah loves you, sister. Allah loves you. You need to go tell them. And with it, please, let's work on our character. Let's become better people. Let's become better humans. Let all this negative media and this whole negative notion and the whole image that's been painted, it's not going to go over a bayan that, no, no, we are not like that. We Muslims are not like that. No one cares what you shout out about. People care what you show them. Just for me and you to become better people. And especially as I mentioned the bullying, please, take it seriously, guys. There are people that are losing their life. And we know that. Over bullying. Over someone making them feel hurt. Even comments like, you're this, you're that. It hurts. It hurts people. Refrain from all this. May Allah allow me to act upon what has been said. May Allah make my ultimate goal Jannah. May Allah make everyone's ultimate goal Jannah. Jazakallah wa khairan ahsan jaza. Mufti Atiq Sahib, Hafizahullah, and all those that were at the Jamia, and all you brothers that have attended. May Allah make you a means of goodness for me and you in this world and in the hereafter. Jazakallah khairan. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi.
JazakAllah khairan for attending. Inshallah, there'll be another talk in a few weeks' time after holidays. The youngsters, really a short one, it'll just be again after Isha. But we don't have any, feel like, any questions for this. So try to keep that touch from the rest of you. Try to keep your diaries empty. Zakat al-Fitr says, well, Isha Salat approaches tonight. If you want to stay behind or get off, we'll try to pray for you, inshallah.